今天我们的这堂课的这个内容就是中阴的修心啊。人死了以后，就是会有一个过渡的这个时间啊。人死了还没有投生啊，这有个过渡的时间，这个叫做中阴。
So tonight, the topic of tonight's teaching is going to be meditation in the death bardo. So after someone dies, there is an intermediate state between their death and their rebirth. This intermediate state is what we refer to as the bardo.
然后这个中阴的这个修法是大乘佛教的这个密法里面讲得非常非常清楚。
As to the bardo state, this is something that the tantric tradition or the tantric teachings within the Mahayana tradition gives very clear instructions on.
然后这个中阴的修法是藏传佛教的这个任何一个教派，比如说像尼玛、噶举等等，所有的教派都有这个中阴的修法。
And as for meditation practice in the death bardo or the bardo of death, this is something that is found in the different traditions of Tibetan Buddhism, whether it be the Nyingma school or the Kagyu school.
我们平时啊，普通人就认为人死了以后一切都结束了，但其实根本就不是这样子。这个我们昨天已经给大家介绍过了。
Ordinary people are of the mind that when one dies, everything comes to an end. But this is not the case at all. This is something that we spoke about yesterday evening.
那么人死了以后还没有结束啊，还没有结束。那么没有结束的话，那么在这个过程当中，到底啊发生了什么事情呢？
So, with one's death, one has not finished. After death, then what happens?
首先，我们昨天啊给大家介绍过了，所谓的死亡啊，实际上就是我们的这个啊眼、耳、鼻、舌、身啊五个感官的这个知觉啊，逐渐逐渐的消失。
So, as for so-called death, last night we looked at how this is in actuality nothing but the gradual disappearance of our five sense faculties and their perceptions.
比如说我们的视觉开始停止的时候，我们看东西的时候呢，就是变得越来越模糊。
So when our eye consciousness ceases to function, then we stop being able to see clearly. That which we perceive with our eyes becomes blurry.
然后我们的听觉开始停止的时候，开始消失的时候呢，比如说有人在旁边说话，人在旁边，但是呢，这个声音似乎就是很远很远的声音，听得特别特别的小。那么这个时候呢，就开始啊停止我们的这个耳识，也就是我们的听觉。
When our ear consciousness begins to disappear, then if someone beside us is speaking, it sounds as though their voice was very very far away indeed. Their voice sounds almost inaudible, and this is a sign that our ear consciousness or our sense of hearing is beginning to cease to function.
然后我们的五个感官的知觉全部消失了以后呢，然后我们的五个感官就从此以后就不再工作啊，停止工作。
So after all of our five sensory perceptions have dissolved or disappeared, they cease to function, they cease to operate.
然后五个感官的直觉消失了以后呢，然后我们的意识的活动也就开始消失。
And after our five sense faculties, stop functioning, then our, mental consciousness also begins to cease its activity.
最后只剩下这个阿赖耶识，除了阿赖耶识以外的全部的这个精神，都停滞了，都消失。
And finally, all that remains is our all-ground consciousness. The other layers of consciousness have all disappeared or ceased to function.
那么这个过程当中，比如说我们从我们的视觉开始消失，到最后就是只剩下阿赖耶识，在这个过程，就是这个当中呢，就是有一个过程。
So from the very beginning, when our eye consciousness starts to disappear, to the very end, when we are left with nothing but our all-ground consciousness, this entails a process. There is a process between these, the beginning and the final point.
但是这个过程啊，是什么样子？在这个过程当中发生了什么事情啊？我们普通人都是一无所知。
However, as to the nature of this process, what it is and what happens in its midst is something that ordinary people have no understanding about.
死亡，它就是一个我周期性的生命的活动，周期性的，比如说我们的任何一个这个食物，它都有周期，比如说我们的这个地球有一年四季365天这是一个周期。然后呢，比如说月亮在它的这个轨道上它的轨道上也有它的这个它的周期。然后任何一个其他的天体它们都有它们的周期。同样的，我们的生命也有周期。
Death, in fact, is just a cycle in the course of in the course of a life. So, any kind of object, any kind of phenomena, is subject to cycles. So, we have four seasons in the course of 1 year. We have 365 days.The moon has its own cyclic orbit. Other constellations also follow their own cycles. It's exactly the same with our lives and lifespans. They are all subject to a cyclic law.
我们的宇宙整个的银河系它有周期，然后太阳系它也有周期。然后太阳系当中的地球它也有周期，任何一个事物都有它的周期性。
Our universe, the Milky Way galaxy, it has its own cycles, as does the solar system and as does the earth. So any phenomenon has its own cycles.
然后我们的这个生命的周期是什么就是有两个可以说三个。那三个，第一个是什么呢？从我们一个生命的诞生到最后成佛这个是一个大的周期。
What about the cycle of life then? What are the cycles of life? Well, we can say that there are three major life cycles. The first is from the birth of a being to the point that the being achieves Buddhahood. This is one major life cycle.
那这个时间是没有办法用我们人类的时间来计算。有可能是一个几十亿，有可能几百万年，有可能几千万年， 这个都说不清楚，是一个非常非常漫长的过程。
As to the period of time entailed in this cycle, it's not possible to use human or ordinary concepts of time to estimate how long this would take. It might be a million years, a billion years, more than this, in any case, an extremely long time.
这个比如说就是一个数字从零开始，比如说我们的计算器计算器不是电脑，计算器。然后计算器从零开始计算加减乘除，然后呢最后它要归零它要归零那我们的零是什么零就是我们的佛心如来藏。从如来藏佛心当中诞生了一个生命，然后在这个轮回当中流转了很长很长漫长的时间，然后最后由会到这个如来藏回归真正的自然，这个就是一个大的周期。
We can liken it to a calculator that always begins with the digit zero, and regardless of what calculations we perform, the figures that we multiply to achieve, ultimately the calculator returns to zero. So similarly, when a being arises from its fundamental state of Buddha nature, and then spends a very long period of time wandering in cyclic existence, and then ultimately, finally returns to the primordial state of Buddha nature, this can be considered as one big cycle.
然后第二个周期，第二个周期，一个人投生到最后的这个死亡最后的死亡就是人的一生是一个中等的一个周期。
So after that major life cycle, there is a second life cycle which refers to the period between the birth of a being to their death. So this is this lifespan in the course of one life. So one lifespan, this is the second level of, or the second cycle within the life cycles.
这个就像数字，比如说我们从一数到一百这样子的话，那么每九个数字以后就会又回到一个零十个、二十、三十每九个以后就会又回到一个零就是这样子。我们在这个大的这个周期里面，然后就有很多很多小的周期这个就一个人的诞生到死亡之间就是一个周期。
So it's like if we were counting from say 1 to 100, every 9 digits we would return to 10 or a multiple of 10. And it is like this with a human lifespan. Within the greater life cycle that we just spoke about, individual lifespans are like these increments of 9 digits. So there are many small cycles contained within a larger cycle.
然后最小的生命的这个活动周期每24小时就会发生一次。
And the shortest cycle that occurs within the life cycle is one that takes place every 24 hours.
那么为什么人的这个24小时每24小时发生一次的周期是什么就是我们进入了深度的睡眠，进入了深度睡眠，然后开始做梦回到现实生活，然后呢又开始进入深度的睡眠那么这个是每24小时之间 就会产生的一个小的生命的周期。
So what is this short 24-hour life cycle? Well, it is when we enter into deep sleep every evening and begin to dream, and then we wake up. And then the following day enter into deep sleep again. So this process of entering into deep sleep, waking up and returning to deep sleep constitutes the shortest cycle within our overall life cycles.
所以我们今天讲这个肾髓已于死亡啊，肾髓与死亡到底有什么关系？
So when we talk about deep sleep and death, what is the connection between these two states?
深度的睡眠啊，跟这个死亡啊，它的原理啊，死亡的时候到底发生了什么？睡眠的时候进入了深度的睡眠的时候，发生了什么？为什么人有这个深度睡眠啊？为什么人有死亡？原理，这个原理完全是一样的，道理都是一样的。
So the reason why we have deep sleep and the reason why we experience death and what happens in both of these states, the reason or the principle underlying them both is the same.
唯一的一个不一样就是死亡的时候它的深度跟睡眠的时候的深度不一样，深度不一样，原理都是一样的。
The only difference is that when we experience dying, the depth of experience is different to when we have deep sleep. So with the exception of the depth of the experience, the principle, their underlying pattern or principle is the same.
我们比如说啊，准备进入睡眠。到最后真正进入睡眠这个过程当中，我们的眼耳鼻舌身还有我们的意识，他们都在逐渐逐渐的消失啊，逐渐逐渐的消失，但是呢我们根本就感觉不到啊，我们睡眠的时候发生了什么我们感觉不到，我们普通人都感觉不到。
When we enter into deep sleepOr when we are preparing, ready to enter into deep sleep, gradually our five sensory faculties and our mental consciousness disappear. But an ordinary person doesn't realize or doesn't perceive this as happening.
但是有一个方法，比如说像 Google 地图啊 ，Google 的地图啊，我们只看到一个地球，然后把它放大、放大、放大以后呢，看到一个城市。然后就看到车、人、建筑物、公路啊，都能够看得到。
But there is a method that we can use, and it is rather like Google Maps. So when we look at Google Maps to begin with, we see the Earth as a globe. But if we continue to enlarge the image, then we are able to see cities with people, buildings, roads, etc.
同样的，我们进入睡眠到最后的深度的睡眠，这个过程是可以放大的。
And in exactly the same way, it is possible to enlarge or magnify the process of entering into deep sleep.
然后放大了一看，啊，它根本就不是啊我们所想象这样，这个里面就有很多很多的层次。
And when we do magnify this experience, we discover that it is not as we thought, and that in fact the experience is made up of many different levels.
就像我们的人体有那么多的细胞，有那么多的毛细血管，但是我们不知道一样。
It's exactly the same as our physical bodies. Our physical bodies are made up of many cells and capillaries, but we don't know about these either.
然后我们进入了这个深度的睡眠， 从深度的睡眠当中开始做梦，从做梦又开始回到现实生活，这个回来的时候啊，我们的意识诞生了啊，眼耳鼻舌身五个感官的知觉也就逐渐的诞生了。这个诞生的过程啊，我们一无所知，我们根本不知道我怎么样从这个梦里面醒过来的，我怎么样从深度的睡眠当中醒过来的，这些我们都感觉不到。
And when we progress from the state of deep sleep to the dream state, and then from the dream state begin our process of returning to the waking state, our sense faculties and our mental consciousness gradually begin to re-arise. However, despite the fact that they are gradually re-arising, we never have any... We never realize this to be happening. We never perceive it as it happens. We don't know how it is that we wake from the dream state.
然后这个过程放大了以后呢，那这个也就是不是我们所想象，这个里面有很多不同的层次、阶段。
And just the same, if we were to magnify this.Process as well, we would discover that it is made up of many different levels and stages.
所以啊，这个，比如说死亡也好，梦也好，啊，深度的睡眠，啊，这些都是我们不了解。我们不但是不了解死亡的真相，连做梦和深度睡眠的这种真相为什么睡眠的过程当中是什么样子，是怎么样回来的啊，这些我们都一无所知。我们啊，不但是不了解死亡，连这个深度的睡眠我们都不了解。
Regardless of whether it is death or the dream state or the state of deep sleep, we don't have an understanding of any of these experiences.So not only do we not understand the truth of death and dying, but even dreaming and deep sleep are something that we don't have an understanding of as to why they take place, what happens when they take place, and how we return to waking consciousness from these states is something that we do not understand.
那么用什么东西把这个过程放大呢？有一个方法叫做梦瑜伽。
So how do we go about magnifying this process then? There is a method, and it is called dream yoga.
如果用梦瑜伽一看，然后我们就看到啊，这个过程当中到底发生了什么。
Through the practice of dream yoga, it is possible for us to discover what is taking place in this process or in these processes.
比如说一个苹果啊，用这个用子弹啊穿透的时候啊，我们的肉眼，因为这个子弹啊，它的速度很快，我们看不见。但是高速摄影机啊，高速摄影机拍下来了以后呢？然后我们才看得清楚这个子弹啊，怎么样？这个一个苹果啊，从左边到右边穿透啊，这个过程它很清晰地拍下来，然后可以给我们的肉眼看。
It's like an apple that has a bullet fired through it. Looking at this with our naked eye, it would be too fast for us to see.Too fast for us to see the process taking place. However, if we were able to capture this event with a high-speed camera, then we would be able to see very clearly the bullet passing through the apple from left to right. And the image captured by the camera would be something we could see then with our naked eyes.
然后这个藏传佛教的密法，它用这个梦瑜伽去了解这个深度睡眠的时候呢，他就发现死亡跟这个深度睡眠的过程都是一样的。
And through the practice of dream yoga in the tantric practices of the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, it is possible to perceive that or to understand that deep sleep and death, what is taking place is essentially the same.
深度的睡眠和这个死亡同样两个都有三个阶段。
Both the state of deep sleep and the process of dying have three stages.
深度的睡眠我们开始的时候就进入深度的睡眠这个时候是没有知觉的，这个是第一个阶段。
So the first phase or first stage of deep sleep is one where we are not conscious. This is the first, or we're not aware. This is the first phase.
然后就开始做梦这个是第二个阶段。
And then the second phase is the dream state where we begin to dream.
然后苏醒又回到现实生活，这是第三个阶段。
And the third phase is that of waking up and returning to the ordinary waking state.
死亡也是一样人断了气以后这个我们刚才讲的意识它停止了以后，然后首先人就会进入一个昏迷的状态。
It's the same with the death process. After the being draws its final breath and consciousness ceases, then the being enters into a state of unconsciousness.
人在这个昏迷的状态当中有可能停几个小时或者是一两天这样子的时间，但是时间是不一定的，大概就是一个这样子的时间，在这个昏迷的状态当中。
The period of time that a person lasts or remains in this state of unconsciousness can be anywhere between several hours and 2 days. So it's not fixed the amount of time one would spend in this state.
这是死亡的第一个阶段。
So that's the first stage or phase of the process of dying.
所以深邃跟死亡这个原理是一模一样的。
So we can see then that deep sleep and death share the same pattern or principle.
然后呢，从这个昏迷的状态当中出来了以后，就开始是中阴的阶段中阴肾，中阴肾。就像梦一样的一个世界。
After the being emerges from the state of unconsciousness, then the bardo of dying begins, and this world or is just like the dream state.
所以就是梦与中阴。
Which is why we correspond dreams and the bardo of death.
最后从梦当中又回到这个现实生活，所以这个苏醒与投生死亡这个中阴身中阴的这个阶段过了以后呢，开始投生。
After the bardo of death has concluded, then the human or being is reborn, and this is like the process of waking from a dream, waking into the ordinary waking state.
然后这个道理明白了以后呢，藏传佛教的密法就通过梦的训练，通过梦的瑜伽，然后去控制死亡的一些，到时候就是把死亡当中发生的一些事情。
So having understood these principles and how they work, then it is possible through the practice of dream yoga to control the process of dying and death and what happens in this process.
这个就叫做这叫做这个梦瑜伽。然后呢，梦瑜伽在思亡的时候真正的去用啊，这个时候就是去实际的运用。那这个时候呢，就叫做中阴的修法。
So, that is we refer to dream yoga. So when we actually take dream yoga, when we actually put it into practice, we implement it at the time of death, then this is what we refer to as meditation in the Bardo state.
就像现在的这个军事演习一样啊，梦可以模拟死亡。
So just like a military simulation exercise, dream yoga enables us to simulate the dying process.
军事演习，它就是在模拟这个真正的战争啊，就像就是。同样的，我们的这个梦瑜伽，它在模拟真正的死亡。
So just as military exercises are simulating war, so too is dream yoga simulating the process of dying.
因为梦和做梦和这个深度的睡眠，跟死亡跟中阴这个过程，还有这个原理啊，这些都是完全是一样的。
Because the principle underpinning or the pattern underpinning dreams and deep sleep and death and the dying process are the same.
所以，他梦瑜伽当中，他训练好了以后啊，训练好了以后，然后到时候死亡来临的时候，很轻松的啊，就控制啊，死亡的时候的一切，都可以自己掌控。
So, by training properly in dream yoga, it is possible at the time of death to very naturally control what takes place in the death process.
然后有一个不一样啊，我们刚才讲这个梦啊，这个睡眠，它最深达到最深的这个程度的时候啊，阿赖耶识还没有突破，还没有这个消失，这个阿赖耶识还存在的。
But there is one difference between the two, and that is that in the state of deep sleep, at the very deepest point of sleep, the all-ground consciousness remains.
然后死亡的时候呢，就有一个非常非常的短暂的时间当中啊，然后这个阿赖耶识它也就停滞了，消失了。
However, in the dying process, there is an extremely short period where the all-ground consciousness disappears. It ceases to be.
那么阿赖耶识都消失了，那么就剩下的是什么呢？剩下的就是我们的心的本心，如来藏。
So, what is it that remains when the all-ground consciousness disappears? What remains is our fundamental basic nature, our Buddha nature.
那么这个时候呢，就这么一瞬间，就这么一瞬间，停滞了阿赖耶识以后呢，这个如来藏光明就一下子就是出现但这个时间是非常非常短暂的。
So, just for the shortest, briefest of moments, when our all-ground consciousness ceases or disappears, then our Buddha nature or luminosity emerges, but the period for which it does is extremely short.
今天我们讲的这个中阴的修法中阴当中呢有很多的修法，但是主要是中阴修法的重点就是要抓住这个机会什么机会？就是没有阿赖耶识的时候的这个机会。
So, in talking about meditation in the death Bardo tonight, well, there are in fact many meditation practices that can be done in the bardo of dying. However, the main point is that we need to take advantage of that very short moment when our all ground consciousness has ceased and our Buddha nature emerges.
所以密法的修行人啊，修行人他不单是没有把这个死亡当作一个绝望恐怖的东西，而且他把死亡就当作一个非常难得的一个修行的机会。
It's for this reason that tantric practitioners do not regard death as a terrible and terrifying experience, but see it as an extremely rare opportunity.
这个在小乘佛教里面呢，就是真的阿罗汉的时候呢，有些是就是在中阴的时候就真悟的，有一个历史的这样子的修行，但还不是啊密法讲的这种修行，这种中阴的修行。小乘佛教有小乘佛教的修行，但他也是在中阴的时候修的。
In the Hinayana teachings, there is also a practice for achieving ahutship in the bardo state. Even though this is also a bardo practice, it is not the same as bardo practice in the tantric tradition.
它为什么是一个非常难得的这个修行的机会呢？
Why is it that this is such a rare opportunity in terms of our practice?
修行有三个这个阶段，第一个可以说是三个阶段，对，第一个是我们现实生活当中修行。
We can say that in terms of practice, there are three different stages. The first is our lives, in our everyday lives.
那么这个时候的这个禅定的这个深度不能达到很深，就是因为我们的眼耳鼻舌身听觉这个视觉都还在所以它会干扰到我们的这个修心，然后意识我们的意识还在，还没有停止，所以呢，我们就活着的时候，或者是我们的这个苏醒的时候大坐的状态再好，也就不能这个像深度睡眠和这个死亡的时候的这个。修行的深度达不到这么深的程度。
So meditation in our ordinary waking state, due to the fact that our sense faculties are still operating, they impact or disturb our meditative concentration.Our mental consciousness still exists too. So this means that in our ordinary waking state, no matter how good our meditative concentration may be, it cannot rival the quality or level of meditative concentration that can be attained in the state of deep sleep or during the death process.
然后梦瑜伽的这个深度睡眠的时候的这个禅修这个修心比我们现实生活当中修的任何一个禅修更加的这个清晰，更加的清楚。
Through the practice of dream yoga in our state of deep sleep, the meditative concentration that we can achieve is more clear and more vivid than any state of meditative concentration we can achieve in our ordinary waking state.
所以我们如果梦瑜伽修得好，我们这个平时大坐的这个境界，它可以把这个境界带到 深度的睡眠当中去修。
So, through the practice of dream yoga, it's possible that we can take our level of meditative realization into the dream state and practice in this state.
因为深度睡眠当中，我们的感官全部都停滞了，然后就是意识的大部分的活动也就停滞了所以只剩下阿赖耶识只剩下阿赖耶识其他都不存在都停滞了所以这个打坐的这个深度比我们现实生活当中的这个深度还要更深层次
Because in our state of deep sleep our senses have ceased to operate and most of our mental activity has also ceased to operate and all that remains is our all-ground consciousness. The depth of meditative experience we can have is much more deep than meditative experience we might have in our ordinary waking state.
但是呢深度睡眠还有这个阿赖耶识还有很细微的这个意识的活动，所以还是会有一些干扰。
However, in the state of deep sleep, we do still have the all-ground consciousness, which means that we still have very subtle activity of our consciousness. Therefore, there is some disturbance.
这个深度睡眠的这个这个修心深禅修比平时的禅修好但是呢没有死亡的时候的没有那么达不到这种深度。
So even though the meditative experience we can achieve in the state of deep sleep is clearer or deeper than that which we can have ordinarily, it is not as deep.Or as clear as the meditation or the meditative experience we can achieve during the dying process.
因为死亡的时候的这么一个瞬间一个瞬间，然后没有任何隔阂的东西，直接这个心的本性如来藏的这个本来的面目实现了这时候。这个深度这个清晰度是比我们的平时现实生活当中的大坐我们闭关大坐还有就是梦瑜伽睡眠的时候大坐都不如这个。
So that moment, at death, when there are no obstacles whatsoever to our meditation and we are able to directly experience the nature of mind, that is, our fundamental nature is for an instant revealed. The clarity and depth that we can achieve at this point is far greater than any meditation we can have in ordinary life, whether it's in a retreat environment or relying on dream yoga or meditation in deep sleep.
那么这个禅定的这个禅定是他活着的时候修的这个禅修的境界就带到这个死亡当中去修，不是我们前面讲梦瑜伽把这个平时的这个境界带到深度的睡眠当中修因为深度的睡眠很安静的，所以这个他修得特别的这个清楚，看得特别清楚。同样的，死亡的时候把这个境界活着的时候所修的境界就带到死亡的这个昏迷的这个阶段，带到这个阶段去修所以这就是更加的清晰，这个力量更大。
So during the dying state or during the dying process, a practitioner is able to bring the level of realization that they have accomplished in their meditation while alive into that state. So just as we saw before, when a practitioner meditates in a state of deep sleep, they bring their level of meditative realization that they achieved in ordinary waking state into the state of deep sleep. And because it is very quiet, they are able to achieve greater clarity. So too, during the death process, the practitioner brings their level of meditative realization to the unconscious post-death state, and as a result, the experience is extremely clear and even more powerful than in the state of deep sleep.
然后这个它的前提条件啊，前提条件，我们这一生啊，必须要真悟啊，没有真悟，如果没有真悟，那么梦瑜伽啊，中阴的修法都是没有办法修的。
So the precondition for this practice is that in this lifetime we achieve enlightenment. Otherwise, without this, it is not possible to practice in the death bardo.
所以真悟对我们来说是非常非常重要，希望大家努力。
So enlightenment is very important. I hope everyone works diligently towards it.
还有真悟了以后呢，我们还要做一点点的训练。
And after having gained enlightenment, we still need to do some training.
这样子以后呢，到时候在中阴的时候啊，阿赖耶识一听至，然后这个佛心如来藏一出来的时候呢，然后立即就认啊，立即就认出来了。
And through doing this training, it will be possible during the process of dying that as soon as the all ground consciousness ceases and our Buddha nature directly emerges, that we will be able to perceive it.
认出来了以后呢，然后就是啊，立即就可以进入这个如来藏的状态当中。
And in recognizing it, we will be able to immediately enter into or abide in the state of recognition of our Buddha nature.
这样子以后呢，他就啊，最好的、最上等的啊，然后他没有中阴了，就在这个当中直接就成就了，直接就成佛了。
In the best case scenario, a practitioner at this moment can directly achieve Buddhahood. That is, it won't be necessary for them to go through the rest of the Bardo process.
所以就是这种人。照到了这种禅定的时候就是比如说一昼，比如说一个星期这样子的这个修心的这个力量超过了就我们普通人一生的一辈子的这个修心。
So for a practitioner like this, 1 week of practice or meditation in this state surpasses the meditation of another practitioner over the course of an entire lifetime.
所以就是很多这个大圆满的修行人就一昼之内他的柔梯比如说像1米7、1米8高身高的人的柔梯就缩小缩到很小很小。
And as a result of this, great realized dzogchen practitioners who may be of a height of 1.7 or 1.8 meters, in the course of 1 week, their bodies shrink to a very small size.
甚至是完全消失。
It's even possible for the body to disappear completely.
因为这个时候的这个如来藏它没有任何念阿赖耶识这样子的这个干扰都不存在，所以直接进入了这个本来的面目的这个状态当中，所以这个禅修的力量是非常非常 巨大的。
Because at this moment, one's Buddha nature is obscured by nothing, including the all-ground consciousness. It is not there. And so the original face of one's basic nature emerges with great clarity and the power of meditative experience at this time is extremely great.
好，接下来我们看一下有几个就是就最近发生，就这么近几年发生的几个这个红山成就的事情。
So I'd like to show you now some photos of some recent practitioners who attained the state of the rainbow body.
这位上师叫做阿丘堪布。就是上世纪九十年代，大概就是二十年前这个弘光的弘山成就。
So in this picture is Kenpo Acho, who in the 1990s, approximately 20 years ago, achieved the state of rainbow body.
然后他弘山成就的时候，他任何东西都没有留下。
And when he achieved this state, he left nothing behind.
当时我也就是专门到他的住处，就去这个调查这个事情。
And at this time, I went to the place where he lived in order to investigate this happening.
然后调查的这个所有的这个有一个记录，所有的内容有藏文的，然后也有中文的，英文的可能还没有，这个整个的这个调查的这个结果都写得清清楚楚的，这我亲自去做的调查。
And the results of my personal research into this phenomenon, I wrote down, I recorded very clearly, and it is now available in Tibetan and Chinese versions. The English version perhaps might not yet exist.
然后这个过程我们没有亲眼看见。
The process whereby it took place was not something that I personally observed.
但是他身边的这些他的弟子他的这些弟子都是一个真正的修行人，我们完全相信他们的这个描述。
However, the descriptions of his disciples who were themselves sincere and real practitioners, I completely believe.
到现在二十年过去了，我们大家都是这么认为，他是真正的这个弘山成就了。
So now, after 20 years, everyone is of the firm belief that he was a real rainbow body attaining practitioner.
因为这个不是不可能的这个藏传佛教的密法的这个历史上出现过很多这样子的人。
And this is not impossible in the over the course of the history of Tibetan Buddhism, in the tantric tradition, there have been many attainers of the rainbow body.
然后这个就是因为他的这个禅定的力量，中阴的这个禅定的力量，就把他的身体转化为另外一个身体。
And this takes place because of the power of these practitioners' meditative concentration during the Bardo stage, which transforms their body into another kind of body.
然后一百五十年前又出现一个大家公认的一个非常了不起的一个这样子的弘山成就，所有的都融化掉，都消失掉，全身任何东西没有留。
150 years ago, there was a practitioner that everyone considers to have achieved the state of rainbow body, and in this case, absolutely nothing was left. Everything was dissolved or disappeared.
但是这样子的弘法，这个弘光呢，我们这个藏传佛教历史上也不是很多。
But examples of this kind are quite few in the Tibetan history of the Tibetan Buddhist tradition.
多数绝大多数他们的身体缩小。
In the majority of cases, the practitioners' bodies shrink.
然后我们可以再看一个另外一个大圆满的这个上师，是一个默默无闻的一个修行人。
So we can have a look here at another picture of a Dzogchen practitioner. And in this case, this practitioner was a completely ordinary, unknown practitioner.
但是一个非常虔诚的这个大圆满的修行人。
But an extremely dedicated practitioner of the Dzogchen practices.
然后2016年去年圆寂了。
And he passed away last year in 2016.
然后这个是中阴的中阴入定中阴入定就是大圆满的修行人他圆寂了以后就是一昼左右然后呢把他的门关起来。任何人不进去也不公开他的这个往生的圆寂的这个消息。这样子以后呢再给他一个非常安静的一个这样子的环境在这个当中修行。一般大圆满的修行人的这个圆寂以后的处理的方法都是这样子。
So in the case of most Dzogchen practitioners, 1 week after their death, the door of their practice space is closed, nobody enters, the news of their death is not proclaimed, and this is in order to give them a quiet environment in which to practice. And in the majority of the cases, this is how the passing of a Dzogchen practitioner is handled.
这里本来有一个侧面的这个照片我们看不出来，不知道什么问题，没有靠背的时候可能没有靠背好。那这个他的这个身体往生了以后呢，还是在保持这个打坐的姿势。
So after the practitioner dies, they maintain the meditation posture.
在一般的这个大圆满的修行人就是一昼以后呢，比如说我们找另外一个非常好的、非常修行非常好的上师或者是他自己的弟子来欢欣的有仪式，有一个仪式有一个仪式，这个念了以后呢，让他从这个禅定里面出来的时候然后他的这个意识就开始离开这个身体，然后呢，身体就开始变成了实体。那么他现在这个时候呢，这个人的脸上就根本就看不出这个实体，就是红光满面的，他就跟活着是一样的，只不过他是没有心跳没有血液循环而已。
So after a practitioner has been abiding in meditation for a period of 1 week after their death, then usually another lama with a very high level of realization or one of the practitioner's own disciples wakes up.The meditating practitioner, and there is a ritual or a liturgy for this, and the purpose is to wake them or to bring them back from this state of meditative absorption. And what happens at this point is that the consciousness then finally departs the body of the practitioner, and then the body starts to decompose and turn into a corpse. But as we can see in the picture, there is nothing that this practitioner doesn't show any signs of death at all. The skin is still very appears very much as if the practitioner was still alive. The only thing missing is the fact that the practitioner does not have a heartbeat.
然后十多年前啊，有一个年纪轻轻的一个修行人，是我们的法王如意宝的一个弟子啊，圆寂了。那么圆寂了以后呢，就是他就是圆寂以后，就是这个一昼之内啊，还是啊这个身体很端正，这个搭坐的这个姿势一点都没有动。啊，然后另外一个这个上师取欢心啊，让他从这个禅定里面出来，有一个这个衣柜仪式做完了以后呢，然后这身体立即就倒下来了。那个去的人亲自给我讲的啊，这种情况到处都有的，不是一个两个，真这是一个真实的啊一个事实。
And Over 10 years ago, there was a disciple of my own guru, Kampuljimi Pudsok. And he, after his passing, spent 1 week upright, meditating and with no movement at all. Then when his disciple went to wake him and recite the liturgy to bring him back from his state of meditative absorption, his body fell right over. And this incident was personally told to me by that person themselves. And indeed, this is not an isolated case. This happens everywhere. There are many cases like this. This is a fact.
这个衣柜啊，这个环心的这个衣柜，就是给他打招呼啊，你这个禅修就差不多了，你应该可以离开这个身体，就是一个这样子的内容啊，这样子的意思。
So the content or the purpose of this liturgy that calls the practitioner back is to essentially let them know that they can finish their meditation and that their consciousness is ready to depart from their body.
啊，这个照片里面呢，看得不是很清楚。这里我刚才讲有个侧面的照片，这个看得更加的清楚。他身体一直都是端正的，啊，这就是其中一个啊。然后最好的时候。啊，这个身体就缩小了，啊，缩小了。这个可能是我们后面的人可能看得不是很清楚啊。他这个缩小了以后呢，就是装在一个很小的这个盒子里面，啊，一个小箱子里面，大概就这个啊，投影仪这么大。然后呢，你看这旁边就有一个人的手啊，就是一皱啊，就这么一皱，一皱，一皱。这个人的手就大概就到这个肉体缩小的这个耳朵这个地方了，那么他的全身就是缩小到这样子的程度。我们一个刚才我们前面看到一个至少是1.67米的人啊，那么他身体现在就是缩小大概就是一肘多一点点啊，就是这样子。最后他的身体还没有完全的消失，但是就缩小到这种程度。
So in this photo, you can see that maybe those at the back can't see clearly, but the body has shrunken to a small size and has been put inside a small box. And as you can see, the person's arm next to the box that is measuring the size of the body shows that the body has shrunken to a size that is approximately 1 cubit's length, so the length between the tips of one's fingers and one's elbow. So this is an example of a person who was originally about 1.67 meters in height, who has shrunken to the size or the length of a cubit. So their body hasn't completely disappeared, but it has shrunken considerably.
你们可以到网上去搜一下这个红参，然后你们会看到一些敷面的解释。
If you go online and you search for the rainbow body, you will discover some negative explanations.
他们说什么呢？他们说这些藏传佛教讲的这个红参肉体缩小完全是骗人的啊！怎么骗的呢？就把人的这个胳膊啊、腿啊、骨头全部去掉啊，然后呢再把它绑起来啊，说是这个啊肉体缩小。但是绝对不是这样的，完全是诽谤。
These people who criticize and slander what is taking place say that in actual fact this whole idea of the body shrinking is a great deception, and that what takes place is the neck is removed, the legs are removed, and then the body is tied up into a bundle. But this is absolutely not the case. It's not the truth.
因为这些上师啊，他们的遗体都是他们的最好的弟子，离他们最近的这些人处理的。
And the reason that we can know this not to be the case is that the bodies of these practitioners are attended to by their closest disciples.
他们每一个人啊，都把这个上师的遗体，就是当作跟佛的身体一样。
And these disciples regard the body of their teacher exactly the same as if it were the body of the Buddha.
根本就不可能我们啊，就是在肉食上看到一样，就是切猪肉、切牛肉一样，这样切成一片一片，根本就不可能的事情。
So it's completely impossible that they would chop up their teacher's body just like a butcher chops up meat.
这个缩小的情况我也调查了、啊、我也调查了，就是给这些人、啊、这个旁边的人、啊、跟他们、啊、沟通了，确实是事实，就是这样子的。
And I also investigated this phenomenon of shrinking and spoke to people who were there, and indeed it is a true phenomenon.
这我们每一个人都有这个机会，每个人都可以身体可以最后就是这么缩小。
Everybody has this opportunity, the opportunity for their body to shrink like this.
但我们会说，缩小了又怎么样呢？缩小不缩小有什么差别呢？
Of course, you might ask, well, what's so good about shrinking? What's the difference between not shrinking and shrinking?
缩小了就是因为我们内在的这个智慧的火焰啊，把我们的肉体都融化的差不多快没有了啊，所以有车可见啊，它的这个禅定和智慧的力量。
In actual fact, the reason for the shrinkage of the body is that the wisdom of the practitioner, the power of the wisdom of the practitioner is effectively melting their body to nothing. So, through this, we can see very clearly the sheer power of the practitioner's meditative realization and wisdom.
我们啊需要的不是这个肉体缩小。我们需要的就是让我们的这么大一个肉体缩小的这个智慧，我们着重的不是肉体缩小，我们着重的是它的内在的这个禅定和智慧的力量。
So what we are seeking is not the shrinkage of the body, but the wisdom that occasions the body to shrink in the way it does. So what we arepursuing is the internal wisdom.
就是这个啊，这个刚才我们看到前面看到的一个，这么大个子的一个这样子的人，最后就是变成啊，你看一个人的手就是放在这里，这一周啊，差不多就比一周大一点点，啊，只有一周高一点点，这个是真的是肉体缩小了。啊，那我们这边看的就更加的清楚，对，整个的人身体缩小，啊。
So in this picture, we can see the practitioner that we saw in the previous photo. That was him at his height when he was alive. In this picture, we can see the size that he shrunk to in his post-death meditation.
然后有比这个还更小的，但是呢，很多这些事情啊，很多都发生在比较偏僻的地方，比较人不多的地方，这样子的地方。所以呢，他们就不一定啊，当时不一定有照相机，不一定有手机，所以很多很多在比较偏僻偏远的地方发生的一些非常非常好的事情，我们没有办法记录，我们看不到。
There are cases of bodies that shrink to sizes that are even smaller than this. However, quite frequently, such occurrences take place in very remote places where there aren't many people. And because they don't have cameras and film cameras and things like this, it isn't possible to record these phenomena. And as a result, we are not able to know about them.Or see them.
藏传佛教，尤其是在西藏的这些真正的这个成就者，这个上师们的弟子，他们的虔诚的心啊，是什么样子？我想你们可能基本也大概了解。
Tibetan Buddhism, especially in Tibetan areas.As to the devotion of the disciples of these great practitioners, I'm sure you can imagine its degree.
所以他们呢，就是像某些人说的一样，在上师身上动手啊，把肉在身体切成一，这个打死他们都不可能的事情，不会做的。
So the very idea that disciples of this kind would do anything to their master's body, such as the people who criticize these phenomena say, is completely impossible.
再说这个肉体缩小啊，在藏区这个很常见的啊，有些时候这个在家人啊，在家居士修行很好的人，他也缩小。所以他的这个上师这么缩小了啊，那也就不能证明与众不同，因为有很多这样子的人。
In fact, in Tibet, the physical shrinkage of a practitioner in this way is a common occurrence. It sometimes also takes place in lay practitioners who are very good.Practitioners. So the fact that a great teacher, great master would shrink like this is not out of the ordinary at all.
好，这是中等的啊，最上等的、最理想的，就是我们刚才前面看的，全部缩小，全什么都没有留的，是最好的。然后这个肉体缩小是中等的。
So this phenomenon whereby the body shrinks is considered a medium level or an evidence of a medium level attainment. The top or the superior level of attainment is considered to be that which we looked at just before where the body disappears into nothing.
第一是全部消失，第二就是缩小。
So the superior level of attainment is when the body dissolves or disappears into nothing, and then the next level below that is when the body shrinks.
那第三是什么呢？
And what then is the third level?
好，我们再看下一个图片。啊，这是一位啊，这个一位堪布啊，一个老堪布，我一个非常非常了不起的一个堪布啊。然后呢，他也是啊，儿龄已流年啊，去年圆寂的。
So this is a picture of an old Kambo, an amazing old Kambo, and he too passed away last year in 2016.
也是我们这个法王如意宝的弟子之一。
And he was also one of Kambo Jimmy Poonsok's disciples.
然后他圆寂了以后呢，他的整个的身体就变成了舍利。
And when he passed away, his body transformed into many small relics.
这舍利就是这样子的。
And this is a picture of those tiny relics.
这个就第三啊，这个算是第三稍微比较低一点的成就。
So these leaving behind relics is considered to be a slightly lesser level of attainment.
有舍利的啊，还是很多的啊，也很多。但是呢，他这个舍利就是整个全身都变成了这样子的舍利。
Cases where practitioners leave behind relics are very common. However, this is a case where the whole body was transformed into relics.
那么这三个这个修心的这个啊这个结果是都跟刚才我们讲的这个中阴的修行有关系。
And in all three of these cases, the results or the attainments were related or connected to meditation or practice in the death bardo, as we have been looking at.
所以这个密法啊，里面呢，因为有了这个中阴的修法啊，中阴的修法，所以它可以全身弘光，肉体缩小。然后整个身体都变成这个舍利啊，它可以做到这些，就是跟这个中阴的啊修法有关系。
It's on the strength of the practice in the intermediate state between death and rebirth that that practitioners are able to attain the rainbow body, shrunken body.Or be transformed into relics. It's precisely through the existence and their practice of meditation methods in the bardo state that this is possible.
然后这个肉体的缩小啊，舍利这些不是啊，现在发生了以后，我们去给他做揭示，这个是成就啊，这个是解脱呀，不是这样。几千年前的佛经。里面呢就有记载啊，成就修心到什么样的程度的时候啊，会全部这个整个身体消失啊，然后到什么样的程度肉体缩小，什么样的情况下啊变成这个舍利，然后舍利有哪种舍利，有各种各样的舍利啊，这些都是几千年前啊就讲得非常清楚的。
And when as to the meanings of these various manifestations, such as when the physical body shrinks and or is transformed into relics, the meanings given to these signs are not attributed recently or in recent times. In fact, more than 2,000 years ago, it was chronicled in the Buddhist scriptures that certain levels of achievement and or attainment, enlightenment and realization correspond with different physical signs. So it was chronicled what level of realization corresponds with the whole body disappearing, the body shrinking, the body turning into relics and so forth.
今天啊，因为时间的关系，我们只是给大家简单的介绍了一下有这么一个修法。
So today, because of time constraints, all that I have wanted to do is give a simple description of this method of practice.
然后具体的啊，有很多的这个方法，有非常具体的方法。
But there are many specific methods of this nature.
那么如果大家感兴趣的话，那就进一步的去学习。
If any of you are interested in these methods, then please continue to study.
密法的这个也不是密法，大乘佛教应该讲大乘佛教的这些修法它不分出家在家，任何人都可以修。
So these methods in the Mahayana teachings do not discriminate between ordained practitioners and lay practitioners. Practitioners of any status are able to practice these methods.
然后如果我们稍微投入一点稍微用一点功，这样子的话，这个结果它的这些结果是自己看得见摸得着，非常实在的。
And if we are willing to invest ourselves in these practices and be somewhat diligent in our practice, then the results that we can yield thereby are extremely tangible and concrete.
然后自己的这个内在的变化是自己非常清楚的，别人看不见，自己非常清楚的。
The nature of one'sinner changes something that a practitioner is very clear about. Other people might not perceive the changes, but one is very clear about them oneself.
我们如果感兴趣的话，所以每一个人都有机会，每一个人都可以去修。
If you're interested in these practices, then everybody has the chance to practice them.
好，今天我们的这个讲座，这个讲到这里，到此结束。
So our teaching for tonight is going to conclude now.
然后我们的人生当中有很多很多很重要的至少我们自己认为是非常重要的，我们一定要去做的事情。
In the course of our lives, there are many things that we consider important to do.
修心修心就是提升自己。
Practice, Buddhist practice is improving oneself.
所以毫无疑问，这是一个非常重要的事情。
So for this reason, without any doubt, it is an extremely important thing to do.
希望大家适当的投入。
And I hope that everyone can appropriately invest themselves in this.
Sonam Deyi Tamja Zubanya Dhamne Nipi Dhamne Bhajri Jirga Nanji Vamon Dhabha这边做连着瓦柱的手我们啊红班子人格的爸妈舍得红我们啊红班子人格的爸妈舍得红我们啊红班子人格的爸妈舍得